Hello everyone, my name is Sarthak. I'm a third year law student at the National Law School of India University, Bangalore, and I'm legal faculty at Blackmutter. Today, we are going to start with a session on the Constitution. The class for this session was taken on the 30th of July, 2021, and this is more of a refresher on what we discussed in class. In this session, we are going to cover four important topics. The first will be just a general introduction to the Constitution, general trivia, that you could expect questions from. Then we'll discuss the Constituent Assembly, the members of the Constituent Assembly, the people who are very important in that, and some important dates that you might need to remember because these are questions that CLAT does ask. We'll discuss the sources of the Constitution and different parts thereof, and we'll discuss the preamble. That being said, there's quite a fanciful thing that people say, that our Constitution is a borrowed Constitution. That in these 2 years, 11 months and 17 days, what the Constituent Assembly has done is that they have ransacked the Constitution from different places, parts of the world, and they have brought together whatever it is that they could find, and they have salvaged different aspects of different constitutions and have made a constitution, a hybrid constitution for India. Now, there is some truth to the matter. There are different parts of the Constitution that are adapted from different parts of the world. However, it is not to be said that it is a stolen constitution or a borrowed constitution. It is more an adapted constitution. As a very young nation at that time, they had the opportunity to see whatever is working best across the world. And from among all of these best practices, they could select whichever practices they thought would be best applicable in India. So from the United Kingdom, they took their parliamentary system because the British had already established a system of governance in India, and they continued with that. They took the British parliamentary system. They took the bicameral form of parliament as well, in that there are two houses to the parliament, the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. Or at the state level, there would be the Vidhan Sabha and the Vidhan Parishad. This bicameral parliamentary system is something that we took from the British. However, the idea of there being a constitutional democracy is something that we took from the USA. Now, the United Kingdom does not really have a constitutional democracy. They have a constitutional monarchy. The Queen is the supreme sort of authority in that country, and all powers flow from her as the leader of the land. However, in the US, they had a Republican democratic system, and it was governed by a constitution. So this entire idea of there being a constitutional system, a constitutional democracy, is something we took from the US. As I mentioned earlier, the preamble, the idea of a preamble, and the general thought behind the preamble is something we took from the US as well. And the fundamental rights, their fundamental rights as expressed in the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments of the US Constitution, is something that inspired our fundamental rights as well. Apart from the fundamental rights, there are also directive principles of state policy in the constitution. These are guidelines to the government about how they should function, how their policy should be. And this idea behind directive principles of state policy is something that we took from Ireland. Something else that we took from Ireland is the presidential election. However, the impeachment of the president we took from the US. So you can see that the drafters of the Constituent Assembly identified different ideas that they wanted to take from different places, and they mixed and matched whatever it is that they thought worked best for India. One of these aspects that they also adopted was the idea of socio-economic justice. Now, justice could be political, justice could be a rhetorical idea. However, that there should be socio-economic justice, that no one in this country should be poor, that no one in this country should face any sort of social backwardness. All of these ideas they took from the USSR, which was a communist state, and the idea of a socialist economy where the government has the authority to redistribute resources is something that we took from the USSR. Later on down the line, during the 1970s, the idea of fundamental duties is also something that we took from the USSR, the Soviet Union. However, these are not the only ideas that we took from Europe. In Europe, another idea that we took from there was from the Weimar Republic, also known as Germany. Now, post-World War I, when the Allied forces came together and formed a government in Germany, they sort of influenced how the state would function. At that time, the German state was known as the Weimar Republic, and the constitution that they had allowed these elected representatives to take over the working of the state in case of emergency. This is the idea behind our emergency provisions as well, that the government at any point of time that it realizes that there's a state of emergency can take over the functioning of the state. The amendment procedure that we have different kinds of amendments. There are simple amendments, there are special amendments, there are special amendments with ratification. All of these amendments for different parts of the constitution. This entire idea behind such a complicated amendment process is something that we took from South Africa. Now, before we go on to what else we took from these countries, we also need to understand that India as I already mentioned, is a union of states. As a union of states, it's a quasi-federal system. We are not an entirely federal system where the government at the center is totally equal to the governments at the state. We are not an entirely unitary system where the government at the center is so powerful and the states don't really have power. We have a quasi-federal system where the state is where the states are somewhat inferior to the center, but the center does not create so much power differential that the states don't have an individual existence. Remember, India is a union of states. These states come together to constitute India. There is no India to begin with that is divided into states. The states constitute India. These different regions, different people, different cultures, all of their existences, they combine together. These entities combine together for there to be an India. And for there to be an India in such a manner, we need to have a quasi-federal system. The idea behind a quasi-federal system is something we took from Canada. Now, in a federal system, you need to have a clear distinction of powers between what the center can do and what the state can do. What the center can do is contained in the center list, whatever the state can, in the union list, and whatever the state can do is contained in the state list. Whatever both of them can do together is contained in the concurrent list. This concurrent list comes from the Australian Constitution, which talks about their different units coming together and working. And in case there are any clashes between the ideas of the state and the idea of the entire territory of Australia, the Union of Australia, in that case, the union would prevail. So the concurrent list operates on that sort of assumption that both the state and the center could make laws on some subjects, but the center's laws would be more powerful than the states. And in case they clash, the center wins. With that being said, there are several ideas that would not be represented either in the union list or the state list or the concurrent list. These ideas are called residuary powers, on which anyone can make the law. The state can as well as the center can. But whenever there is a clash between these laws that are made on residuary powers, the union wins again. The idea of residuary powers, that there are certain subjects that cannot be put down in lists, considering that at the time when this was made, the constitution was made, there were several ideas that were entirely new. So these new ideas and how they are to be regulated and how laws are made to be made on these subjects could be residuary entirely in nature. And if the state makes a law on that, the center can also make a law on that, and the center's law prevails. This idea of residuary powers again comes from Canada. That being said, as I mentioned earlier, we already had a parliamentary system in India. The British had already established legislative assemblies. They had a viceroy's executive council at the center. This entire federal scheme is something we got from the Government of India Act of 1935 that the British Parliament had enacted for India. So this entire scheme is something we continued with. However, we brought in new progressive ideas as well. One of these progressive ideas is the French Revolution's ideals of liberty, equality, and fraternity. These are values that we got, we put in our preamble, and these are values that we allow to govern our own constitution. So these are also new ideas that are a part of our constitution. You can leave any and all feedback in the comments, and thank you so much. Do give your feedback in the comment section, and in case you have any doubts, mail us at hello@clattutor.com. See ya.